financing like a merchant, not like a bank, an equity culture, not a debt culture. And yet we're required to adhere to the same rules as the banks which operate in this debt culture operate. So you're quite right, we are forced to behave in a way that is contrary to what I think should be our purpose. And that's why the Islamic finance, financial services industry has ended up replicating the conventional debt-based industry. And that's sad. And I think what it requires is governments, probably Muslim majority governments, probably somewhere like Malaysia or Dubai, to step up and say, we're actually going to create a completely parallel alternative financing system. And here are the regulations under which that will operate. I think it requires that level. That's a huge, I mean, that's a massive shift away from the conventional financial services industry. I can't really see that happening, probably not even in my lifetime. But you know, I can only do so much to see what can be done to get the best.
I think that's pushing on that is very, because Malaysia has a dual regulatory system, maybe they can't finance it. Unlike the UK, do you need that other solution or appropriate either?
The Malaysian banks still operate like banks. They don't operate like, if you like, venture capital firms. They still see themselves as lenders of credit to borrowers. And that I think is the problem with modern Islamic finance. It's stuck in this old way of thinking. And even the most senior management of these banks are in conventional trade, and that's what they wish to do.
I think this
idea
that it changes everything to happen will probably come from the country. In the West, it's been difficult for us to actually even convince, even commit. If you look at, for example, in Turkey, in Morocco, I think they call it participation banking, they don't even call it Islamic finance. So even in most countries, it's still, there's a lot of education awareness that needs to happen.
Any more questions?
Just stand up and speak up. First of all, thank you very much to your both speakers, in particular to Harris. You clearly have a very strong understanding of the financial world.
You have to speak up, because even I'm struggling.
Obviously, thank you very much to the speakers, in particular to Harris, providing a very sort of strong understanding of the Islamic financial world. But this question is more directed towards Justice Samina. I was wondering, do you have any counter arguments against Harris's critical analysis of the Islamic financial world, and how you could providing solutions to the problem to address.
See, why I'm a bit more optimistic is the fact that to my background, I started off at Merrill, and I started off in a very back office type of role. So I was absolutely nobody in a huge organization where Harris was with layers and layers and layers of management. So I started off by organizing a seminar on Islamic finance, but this seminar really changed everything for me, for the company, in terms of, you know, its diversity policy. So it was off the back of the South Asian network platform. And we must have had like four, I mean, I was covering Middle East markets in my back office, you know, nobody type role. And we must have had, I made sure, like everyone at Merrill Lynch was at that event, you know, including people, compliance, and the cleaners, and just, you know, anyone. And we also managed to get people from all 40 countries that Merrill Lynch operated on a call on Islamic finance. Now, this caused a huge amount of noise within the company, and I annoyed so many people because we had a dedicated desk even in the company on Islamic finance. But because they weren't marketing themselves, because they weren't easily telling people that they were even around, me covering the Middle East market didn't even know that we had such expertise. So then, this lunchtime seminar now, you know, highlights to the firm that there's demand, people are interested in this. So then, the main sponsor of this network forum was Bob Wigley. He's actually one of my mentors. He was the chairman of the company. So not knowing who he was, I went and emailed him and probably annoyed, you know, compliance and HR and so many
it's
people.
Probably an advantage not knowing who he was because you probably. Were able to be quite...
Yeah, so I was junior. I had no responsibilities. I could get away with whatever. So I went into his office, annoyed everyone, but actually playing a political game and copying everyone in an email so they knew what was going on. Went into the office and said to him, listen, these are the kind of queries I'm getting from various business users within the company, and why aren't we looking at Islamic finance? So then he introduces me now to these bank multicultural networks. So this is a collaboration of the top 10 investment bank, and it's dedicated just to diversity. I mean, it's called, it's still around today. So UBS, Goldman, Deutsche, they meet once a month at each other's universities and they discuss diversity. So in this area, there's no real competition because we all want to ensure that, you know, we're not being, you know, judged on gender or our ethnicities or anything like that. And in banking, especially, you find that the middle office guys, they have massive egos. So instead of, you know, allowing talent to get to places, they will actually push you down if they see that, you know, this guy's gifted. So when they introduced me to this forum, and they say that, you know, we want you to give us your ideas because you don't seem scared and you don't seem, you know, you kind of make things happen as well. So we went, so in this internet multicultural network, and one day lying around the table, I had noticed that Deutsche Bank had just done an event as part of some breakfast series. They had got Horace's old boss girl to come down and give a talk about, you know, what was this non-Muslim guy doing in Dubai, talking about Islamic finance, and allegedly in front of the clients and being so passionate about the product. And so he, you know, then I found that we went to UBS and realized that they had also done a similar type of event on Islamic finance. So there was about three or four universities within the forum. So this now gave me ideas that actually this isn't, Merrill Lynch isn't just looking into Islamic finance, they're dedicated just for the industry focused on Islamic finance. So I went back to them and I said, let's do an event on Islamic finance. It took me a year to convince every single person. But you know, there's very people like girl, everyone that was standing in my way, all of a sudden started seeing that actually we need to start raising, working together as opposed to kind of doing our own little thing. And this is a really powerful network to actually educate, I guess, conventional backers in Islamic finance. So the event happened in 2007, and that's when things started dramatically changing for me. Now, where I was at Merrill Lynch Wealth Management, in the whole history of investment banking, you would only find from the investment banking scene, Citi were the only ones that came into Islamic wealth management products. No one else out there was. What made it easy for me was the fact that I was already sitting in wealth management. So it was easy enough for the boss to turn around, if they don't offer me a job, someone else will. So then all of a sudden, I got promoted from being a nobody to kind of now developing their Islamic finance strategy. Between the, all, you know, during the whole struggles and everything that I saw, the one thing that hit me was that these guys were completely ignorant about Islamic finance. And you know, like the top CEO, you might come across Islamic finance on Sunday, kind of over breakfast, looking at the FTO, Islamic $1.5 trillion. That's the only real pleasure. And I hope, I know this has been recorded, but there were a couple of deals that we had lost internally, massive deals, to the likes of probably Deutsche, because there was so much ignorance within the organization. And I know one of the guys who actually left the organization out of protest, because you know, you've been pitching 2 years trying to get this client on, and all of a sudden your bosses are turning around and saying, well, what's this going to do? And also, I think the media and what's happening in the wider kind of context influence probably a lot of thought behaviour. So this is why I believe that we're still at very, very infancy level of waking up the financial commercial market. And to be honest, this was one of the reasons why I wanted to leave, you know, going back as an employee and setting up my own consultancy firm. And actually now going to, because I believe that when you go to a lot of these Islamic finance conferences, you'll find the same, you know, people. Why are you converting this? We need to now go out there and start telling the conventional world what Islamic banking is all about. So I'm actually, my mentor Bob Wigley introduced me to the Guild of International Bankers Forum, and I mean the average age of there is 55, so you can imagine what kind of forum this is. And he fast-tracked my whole professional membership. So I decided to join the club, which is fantastic. And I get to meet the CEOs of most, you know, a lot of conventional banks out there. So this is my opportunity now to sell the sectors to them. And so I think change will come, but it will be a slow process, which is why actually I'm kind of a bit more optimistic about the future, because I don't think Islamic finance has really reached its potential.
Mine's sort of a bit more ideological. You mentioned earlier about the nature of money. How credible and what is the process of making these products in the way that art is Islamic, in the sense that if we're running on a system of this fiat economy of everything don't even know where ownership lies with this paper that we're holding that really has no value, intrinsic value or value with anybody just because we as a society think it has value. How do we create, how are these products being created by scholars who aren't even acknowledging the fact that from its very basis, it's not very Islamic, it's all users. How are we then,
let me give you a specific example.
Just
for the benefit of I'm not sure the camera's picking up anyway, but the question is, given that the nature of money in the modern financial economic system is as it is, how do we reconcile that with the nature of money in the Islamic economy? Let me give you a specific example. About 6 years ago, when I worked for Deutsche Bank, we were approached by a private equity firm that was going to be the largest buyout in the Middle East. So they were going to buy a company called Egyptian Fertilizers Company. And it would have been for an enterprise value of $1.9 billion, which is not a small change in anyone's money. And it had to be done Sharia compliant because the fund was an Islamic fund. So initially, of course, what people do and what bankers tend to do is they say, I will use a commodity model. It looks like a loan, it smells like a loan, it feels like a loan. I can get my credit traders comfortable, I can get my compliance department comfortable, I can get my legal guys comfortable, etc. But the scholar is very good, right? Like the Sheikh Hossein Hamad Hassan, who's an 80-something Egyptian scholar, who hates the commodity model as a proxy for loan financing, as he should. He said, there is a better way to do this. Go away and think about it a bit more. So we went away as the Islamic structuring team at Deutsche Bank, and we said, okay, it's got to be a real economy, so how do we do this? This is a company that manufactures fertilizer. It takes urea and processes it and ships it around the world. Why don't we do a forward purchase of that asset, of that product that this company manufactures? So instead of lending it $800 million in senior debt tranche and expecting interest back in return, or creating a sham structure called commodity monopoly, which effectively does the same thing, why don't we contractually agree to buy $800 million worth of fertilizer over the next 8 years, which was the term of the loan, right? So here's an investment bank, a Western investment bank, that is agreeing to the forward purchase of a manufacturing commodity, an entirely new economy transaction. This is a bank acting as a merchant, not acting as a bank lending money. It's saying, I want $800 million worth of bags of fertilizer in my mail room over the next 8 years. Of course, we don't literally do that. We don't literally have these, you know, mail room inundated with sacks of fertilizer. What we do is we arrange an offtake. So we have a third party who buys this and guarantees that they'll continue to buy it over the next 8 years. And we're taking credit risk on that. That's a real economy transaction. It's known as an istisna. It's a type of contractual structure in Islamic finance. And it is fantastic because, of course, originally, the emerging market structure in Desert Deutsche, they just went insane. And they said, you guys are nuts. There's just no way you can consider. I mean, you live in a sort of parallel universe where this stuff doesn't happen in the real world. But eventually, everybody got outside. The credit traders, the compliance department, the legal people. It took time. You know, it was hard work. But they all got outside in the end. And, you know, guess what? When the deal was done, we closed the largest ever buyout in the Middle East. Not just Sharia compliant, but the largest ever, whether conventional or Sharia compliant. People said, oh, I did this deal. Every single person in the bank claimed, you know, success has many fathers and mothers. Right? So all of a sudden, something that was completely impossible and couldn't possibly be done that way was done in that way, and everybody got credit for it. So that's an example of how you can apply real economy, ethical Islamic finance techniques to do a transaction.
Yeah, my question was more on the basis of not real economy, more as it's the medium exchange of just using currency. How are we going about dealing with that problem with scholars that aren't being quite, like, the question hasn't ever been put,
we're not,
being put
we're not,
as being
we're not.
The
and,
problem with the currency.
And we don't have anyone of the caliber of Azad and Imam Abu Hanifa. We don't have people of that caliber anymore.
Does that mean that then just advocating or promoting things as Islamic finance is...
It's going to come to you guys. Somebody here has to step up and do it. It's not going to be me. It's not going to be the bankers that I work with. It's not even, unfortunately, going to be the scholars that I work with. It's going to be somebody of your generation who's going to do it. But I can't see it happening in my career.
And the conversation doesn't exist at the moment.
It exists on the fringes in the same way as the conversations that a guy like David Graeber has context about how money originates as debt, and how debt is an egregious form of violent coercion. That's a conversation that happens in the fringes. Your university, I'm sure, does not teach an economics course, an alternative economics course, does it?
No.
I don't know. It does. Tell me about it. Because that's the first time I'm hearing it. Anyone want to volunteer what it talks about?
No, I can't suppose.
Yeah, we have plenty. So we have some that focus on gender, some that focus on the Middle East, etc.
So they talk about alternative economic systems like Islamic finance, for example, like the Islamic economy?
There was a course in Islamic finance that's not on.
Yeah. Islamic finance is a course that really, basically tells you how to do contractual structures. But what I'm saying is that universities in general don't teach that our modern notions of economics are just total nonsense. According to a guy like David Graeber, they're total nonsense. But nobody wants to listen to that voice, because this is the lunatic who's a self-confessed anarchist who holds up traffic on Wall Street, right, with thousands of people doing a sit-in protest. So he's obviously an anarchist, right? According to the establishment. But until the establishment recognizes this guy has a valid argument with an intellectual basis, we're going to struggle. Universities will not teach that subject.
I'm still following up on that. I'm sorry for taking up some time. But if there is sort of no such thing as Islamic finance, why are we, is it just that we're making money off Muslims in the sense of we're selling something that they could at least be not bothered with because they could get something else that's maybe a bit more lucrative?
Yeah.
Because unless they could be ethical, if not Islamic finance, and we'll make the money out of
Muslims. That's what a guy like Omar Logan says. This is the scholar that I met to conclude my book. He says that you guys are preying on people's religious insecurities.
Yeah,
why? You're just making money out of religious insecurities. And I do have sympathy with that argument. But I think if we don't struggle against the status quo, if we don't try and make a difference, then it's going to be, I hate to say this, but if you look at the demographic profile of senior management at the five British Islamic banks, they don't look like me, and they're not Muslim. And that's not to say that non-Muslims don't have a very valid contribution, a very necessary contribution to this Islamic finance industry. And why do the senior management of, what was the only Islamic bank that I can name, certainly outside the Islamic world, is composed almost entirely of people who don't step inside the shoes of the Islamic investor? They can never do unless they actually believe what they do. Lady behind you.
Along
those
lines, how do you break the fact that the very proponents of Islamic finance, the leaders of Islamic nations, the likes of those that bear about Citigroup, Barclays, are they really actually proponents of the laws they're meant to be preaching, subscribing to, or promoting to their people when they are investing heavily?
I'm smiling because my answer is going to get me banned from visiting some of these countries.
But they're investing, either rescuing or still working on World Fund taking exceptionally large stakes in, you mentioned P&O, companies that, I mean, the percentage of actual Islamic finance business they're engaging in is minimal, it's zero. So you're saying that the West, the bank space in the West, in England, are run by non-Muslims. How is it that the leaders of nations, those that sit above the top, the biggest sovereign world funds, are actually going against
an excellent
the principles that they're meant to?
It's an excellent point. I don't know if you want to tackle it first. I think it's diplomatic very much.
Sorry, Samina. The people in the guest saying, I probably didn't want to answer that question.
Islamic finance is in compliance with my say too, which is
you do see ethics, and it's interesting, for my days at Merrill, I found that it was the women that were actually pushing their husbands to turn towards Islamic finance, which is why I think women have a huge role to play in the development of Islamic finance, coming back to the real core.
Is it possible when, like I said, the leaders of nations, the sovereign wealth funds of these nations, are actually then investing in companies that absolutely are against the principles of the religious elements and the financial concepts you mentioned promoting?
You could argue that senior management of all these banks are conventionally trained bankers, who maybe didn't have a particular love, a particular interest in ethical financing, and banking happened to be a lucrative career for them to join. And therefore they are agnostic as to whether they use Islamic finance or other forms of ethical finance. Steps are being taken. So the ruler of Dubai, for example, has announced that Dubai will become the capital of the Islamic economy. That's great. Now we need some real action. It's one thing to have a decree, and it's one thing to make grandiose statements, but it's another way to put them on the ground. And it would be great if the central government of one of these countries said, we're going to have a power in the economic system, and here's how it's going to work, and there are some practical steps. Mm-hmm. But you're quite right that the sovereign wealth funds have no interest. Their primary interest is making money and preserving their wealth. I think we tend to find, as people get richer, that they tend to forget that the reason why they got rich was not because they themselves were particularly intelligent or hardworking or whatever attributes they may have had, but actually because they were in the right place at the right time and they got lucky. I don't call it luck, I call it fate. For me, it's called this, which is providence from God, which is preordained. If you're going to be rich, you're going to be rich. What's important to me is how you earn blessing from whatever you've been given in life, whatever material possessions and material wealth you have. So you may as well do it right, because I'm only going to be as rich or poor as has already been ordained for me by God. So maybe you can argue that those people are people who don't necessarily feel that their riches and their position are as a result of divine providence, but actually it's because it was entirely down to them. And I guess that means you need to be fierce. Does that help?
It's definitely an interesting insight, but I think that perhaps that could be deemed hypocritical, and does that actually undermine exactly what the principles are trying to achieve?
I think these people are pragmatists. So on the one hand, they have to live in the real world, and they have to be a friend to certain nations around the world. And on the other hand, they've got to exist in the global economic system. And on the other hand, they recognize that Islamic finance is a work in progress. So we started with the commodity market and started to say, yeah, that's okay for the time being, because it'll help to grow the industry, but now we want to move on to something a little bit more pure. And I think some people need to play catch up there. Maybe some of those are the world leaders who are looking to Islamic finance for answers.
I'm just wondering whether before you started, you actually found out from the audience by show of hands how many people maintain account with Islamic Bank. That would be interesting to see, because I'm making this point because the whole discussion is about confidence in the banking system, whether it really works or it serves the people. This thing said so this slide that you show fantastic works. Banking products. I'm wondering from your experience whether these products have really had impact in the lives of people, such that whether you have some examples so that we can with them.
Yeah, I think that's
good.
That's a fantastic point. So the thing is, if you look at Islamic finance from the retail perspective, just here in the UK, how many Islamic mortgages really are there? Okay, HSBC, now they're then you see
can I just say something about HSBC, I'm going to say this now. Don't put your money in HSBC. Take your money out. And why? Because they're the only bank
who has publicly closed the bank accounts of every online customer in the world except for two countries. So I have an account in the UK and I have an account in the UAE where I used to work. And they close that account, so I don't send a check. That's the first thing. The second is, their senior management do not give a shit about dying children in Syria and Gaza. And they close the accounts of our charities who are feeding those mouths. So don't put your money, don't reward those people, because the British government is rewarding those people. You're going to have to cover this one. The British government is rewarding HSBC by awarding them the mandate to arrange David Cameron's coup last year. That is wrong. And we shouldn't reward that kind of behavior. And we as consumers continue to reward these bankers for the wrong types of behavior. So I would urge you, if you believe in Islamic finance or ethical financing, to move your bank accounts, move your money away from banks like HSBC, into banks like Islamic Bank of Britain. Now, you asked about confidence. Why would you not be confident about putting your money in IDB? What is it about IDB? I'd be interested to hear. What is it about opening a bank account with Islamic Bank of Britain that makes you nervous? Or maybe, you know, if you're not, it's not Islamic finance, then you know, the cooperative or another, you know, so-called ethical bank. What is it about those institutions that makes you nervous?
So you say there's some, that's that, it's likely that more problem, opening to the media, it's not somewhere transparent.
Yeah.
Whereas other banks are straight on at this interest.
Okay, so the one is that you're concerned about whether it's Islamic or not, I'll address that in a second. Any other concerns? Is your, yeah.
Well, one thing is that they effectively offer the same products which you can find elsewhere, but their downside is that they don't have the same expertise.
Okay, so quality, possibly performance. So it's not just quality and performance, anything else?
In the case of a crash, they don't have that kind of backing.
Okay.
And we want all our money to be secure at the end of the day.
So I'll answer that one first, because that's the easiest one. It's backed by the government's guarantee. So if the bank collapses, it's regulated by the UK regulator and your money is safe, up to a certain level, which is the same for all banks. So that's the easy one to answer. So your money is as safe as it can be in this country, right? Performance and quality, it's catching up. And the reason why it has taken a while is because you guys continue to put the money with banks like HSBC. So as long as your money is sitting with those banks, they have cheap cost of funding. They're big, they're powerful, they're highly rated from a credit perspective. Smaller banks are riskier and therefore have lower credit rating, therefore their internal cost of funding is higher, and therefore they pass on that cost to you, the consumer. So it's like in our food industry when, you know, my father came to this country in the early 1960s. There was no halal food industry in this country. And initially, advertising would be set up and it would be more expensive, the meat was more expensive. Now, halal meat is cheaper. Why? Because it makes economic sense, because Muslims disproportionately need to register about the meat. And non-Muslims, and then the advertisers say, okay, you need to make these abattoirs, you know, fully Sharia compliant. Okay, there's another argument about what's halal and what's not halal. Okay, that's a different argument. So it's become cheaper because of economies of scale. If you don't patronize Islamic banks or ethical banks with your deposits and your demand for product, they are never going to become cheaper or better quality. So you have to start somewhere. So that's my response to that. And the response to is it Islamic or not? That's really the hardest question. I believe the industry is a work in progress. And I think there is a very, very small band of people who are trying to change it for better. But unfortunately, the majority, and I really did hesitate to talk about people who were not investors, were not buyers of the product themselves in senior management positions. I mean, it would like be, I mean, non-Muslims have a very valid role to play, and indeed, you know, Islamic finance is not only for Muslims, it's for non-Muslims as well, as somebody pointed out. Imagine you had, you know, somebody who ran an animal rights agency and wore fur coats. It wouldn't make any sense. I mean, they didn't believe in what they sell. You saw last year Panorama did a documentary on comic relief and Save the Children, and they discovered that they were investing their money in areas that didn't match the sentiments of their donors. So tobacco and alcohol and all sorts of things. The Church of England got pulled up recently because